Hey everyone, I chose the subject of this episode of That's All I Have to Say About That by asking people on my Facebook page to request a Supreme Court case. And this was the first one to come up. So without any further ado, we're talking about 1938's case Connecticut General Life Insurance Co. versus Johnson. Unfortunately, this was in the 1930s, a time when you were more likely to find an African-American female in Congress than a recording device that could pick up decent audio. Even worse, the only place I could find a copy of the transcript was Amazon. Oh yeah, good job writing that 44-page book, Raymond Benjamin. How did you ever come up with those beautiful arguments? In one of the most chilling Supreme Court experiences I've had, I can't afford to view older transcripts. So, if you want the exact arguments that led to things like Dred Scott or other influential decisions, I recommend you start saving your money. I mean, just look at the Supreme Court's website. What are you trying to do? Keep this stuff a secret? Alright, so enough griping and on to the actual case, which was trying to determine whether a corporation can do business in a state and claim the 14th Amendment protects them from additional state laws. Alright, so how does the 14th Amendment work in this case? Ah yes, the amendment that declares corporations as more human than fetuses. Well, to understand how this amendment works, we need to go back to 1886's Santa Clara versus South Pacific Railroad. A time when this county was trying to deprive corporations of essential rights that were granted to individuals. Specifically, the right to deduct a mortgage from property tax when paying taxes. Man, did the railroads get sued by the Supreme Court an amount that would make Donald Trump think they have to get their act together. A basic search revealed at least 22 cases were against railroads. Forget pioneers, I think the people to benefit most from railroads were the lawyers who decided to stay in DC. So what's this case decide? Well, it stated that you can't apply different taxes to individuals and corporations. The important part as it relates to the case we're talking about today though is, how does the 14th Amendment fit into all this? Because the 14th Amendment, which was designed to give rights to slaves, was written with more artistic flair than a teenager trying to stretch out his research paper to a few more lines. So it can be interpreted in all sorts of ways. But today, we're specifically focusing on the Equal Protections Clause, which says, "Nor shall any state deprive any person of life, liberty, or property without due process of law." Alright, sounds straightforward enough. Well, an argument was made that instead of using the word person, they could have used a word like human being if they had wanted it to be just people or human beings. Apparently, the thesaurus hadn't arrived yet though, and they didn't think it would have made a big difference. The court further ruled that the life and liberty portions did not apply to companies because, well, it would be ridiculous to apply those portions to corporations, which would leave some to think, obviously the entire thing doesn't apply. But that is not what the court thought, as they deemed equal property rights to both people and corporations. This was the first case to recognize that corporations are represented under the Equal Protections Clause of the 14th Amendment. It was decided in this case that, because the 14th Amendment protected a company's property rights, a government entity cannot apply different property taxes to companies and individuals. Alright. So, back to the case at hand. Connecticut General Life Insurance Co. versus Johnson. In this case, there was another state tax question. Alright, so there was this company, Connecticut General Life Insurance Co., or CIGNA, because apparently someone doesn't know how acronyms work. Although, I do see why they didn't decide to go with CGLIC. Anyways, Cigna was an insurance company because, yo dog, I heard you like insurance, so I insured your insurance so you can collect your insurance while you collect on your insurance. And let me tell you, it was 1938 America, so believe me, there were plenty of people wanting insurance. Although, I can't imagine how in the Great Depression America, people were really jumping at the opportunity to give money to people protecting them from financial ruin. But somehow, they were getting by. So, Connecticut General Life Insurance Co. was looking to expand to California. Now, because I'm not a constitutional tax accountant, yeah, I bet that's a thing, I'm going to quote the decision that was made so I'm not misinterpreting it at all. The tax would be, upon the amount of the gross premiums received upon its business done in the state, less return premiums and reinsurance and companies or associations authorized to do business in this state. So that sounds way too boring to be at all controversial, but it was contested at the time because the idea of doubling taxes, meaning that this company was paying taxes on gross premiums made in the state and then being taxed again in Connecticut. Alright, so we have to pick apart every word of the Constitution to figure out exactly what the four-page essay that summarizes our entire government structure says about the intricacies of interstate taxation. So what did the decision say? Well, it was found that the way the tax was currently written was unconstitutional because basically the tax was too broad and focused on taxing the company's profits rather than the company's profits from that state. Which would be like renting someone a room on Airbnb and then making them pay your homeowner's insurance. Alright, so what does the 14th Amendment have to say about that? Well, it limits the state's legislative jurisdiction to the tax of only economic benefits and burdens of transactions within their state. Basically, this means that if you're a state, it's unconstitutional to have economic successes and burdens that occur outside of your state impact the amount that you charge a company, not headquartered in your state. Just a quick thank you to the person who requested this episode. I hope I answered all of your questions on this particularly obscure and specific case. This case is a Wikipedia page shorter than a book report from a middle schooler who hasn't read the book. And I'm the very first person to make a video covering this case. Anyways, hope this helps you with your taxes? But please don't quote me if you get audited. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, I hope you enjoyed that last video. If you want to request a case, write it down in the comments. For more episodes of Supreme Court Saturday, click here, and remember to subscribe by clicking here. And don't forget to like this video down below.